A very warm welcome, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Andreas Patzer, and I'm working for Vector since some years in the product line Measurement and Calibration. And one of the topics or the main protocol we have at apartment is the XCP. So the webinar is about XCP, and together with my colleague here, Holger Heid, he's responsible for all the technical stuff of the webinar. We will have the next 60 minutes to talk about XCP. If you have any content-relevant questions, please use question and answer session, and we will try to answer the questions during the presentation. So let's start with XCP. Some basic things about XCP will be our first topic. Then we will talk about some details of the ECU possibilities to handle XCP, how to integrate an XCP driver, for example. We will talk about some use cases, how, where can you use XCP. And after that, we see some examples, demos, and you get some additional information where you can get some more detailed information. Let's start with the basics. XCP is an ASAM standard. That means ASAM is an association for standardization of automation and measurement. And in these ASAM groups, vehicle OEMs, suppliers, and tool vendors like Vector are working together to define standards. On the right side, you can see the ASAM interface model regarding XCP. First, here the ECU. It contains an XCP driver for the communication with the measurement and calibration system. From the Vector point of view, for example, the measurement and calibration tool is Canopy. You can also use Canoe, but Canopy is the first, there was the first XCP master for handling XCP and measurement and calibration. This interface is address oriented. That means a communication between the master and the slave. Oh, sorry, first I have to explain, it's a master-slave concept in XCP. So the measurement and calibration system is the master and the ECU is the slave. And when the master wants to talk about the content of an object, he sends a question to the ECU, to the XCP driver. What is the content of address 1000, for example? Then the ECU, the XCP driver in the ECU, will take a look at the address 1000 and will the answer sent back to the measurement and calibration system, to the master. But human beings don't want to work with numbers. We want to work with object names. And to realize that, we have a second interface here where a description file shows the relationship between the name and the address of the object. So one of the most important thing here at the description file, so-called A2L file, ASAM second interface language. So the name A2L is quite simple. The content of the memory here and the address is defined here in the description file. So this is responsible for the complete XCP part. Here we have an additional interface, interface number 3, to connect an automation system with the measurement and calibration system. This is not relevant for the next few minutes about XCP. So what we mentioned already is it's address-oriented, and the complete goal of the XCP is to handle measurement and calibration. So we have a read and a write access to the content of the ECU. We have two different kinds of handling measurement stuff. It's polling, so-called polling. It means like, give me the content of address 1000. And we have DAQ, that stands for data acquisition. Data acquisition is an event-driven kind of measurement. We will see later on a little bit more about that. To change a parameter in the ECU, we can calibrate a parameter in the ECU memory. For example, we can say, on the address 2000, there's a parameter, and I want to set the parameter value to 5. This would be a command from the measurement and calibration system, from the master to the slave. There's an additional thing you can do with XCP. It's a so-called bypassing. That means that we can read out information from the XCP slave. We can calculate on the measurement and calibration system side information and algorithms, and we can send back the results of the algorithms by stimulation into the ECU again. So DAC, data acquisition, and stimulation are related to events in the ECU. We will see this a little bit more in detail later. First, an overview about the communication between the master and the slave. The master, the measurement and calibration system, and here is the slave, and we have two kinds of communication, let's say. One is this one, called CTO, command transfer object. We can transfer objects between the master and the slave, and we can get a response to the command. Or here we have the possibility to send data information. A data information can be sent by the slave to the master, then we talk about data acquisition, or it can be sent by the master to the slave, then it's called stimulation. Together, they can realize the bypass. I think there was a question. Are the commands the same on XCP than CCP? Are they compatible, or are there additional features to this? The commands are pretty the same, but not definitely all the same, because XCP has more functionality than CCP. So we need an additional subset of commands between master and slave. The commands are described in the standard document as well, but I will give you some more links to information where you can find the commands responsible for the XCP communication. Thanks for the question. Another topic for XCP, XCP basic information, is that XCP is not an one-block communication protocol. It's divided into two different tiers. One tier is the protocol layer. This is the implementation, the code instrumentation in the ECU. And the next tier is they are the transport layers. So quite common is XCP on CAN, quite the same like we had before, CCP on CAN. But we have also XCP on FlexRay, XCP on Ethernet, and others. And but these three are the most used protocol combinations. And what does it mean? When you have an ECU and you have your code, you instrument your code with XCP commands. And for example, in the first phase of your development, the ECU has an Ethernet interface because you need a lot of data out of the ECU. But when you come to the start of production phase, you can't use Ethernet anymore in the car. You need CAN. So the instrumentation of the code is exactly the same. You change just the communication transport layer part. So for example, over CAN, we have a limited amount of data that we can send by one message. It's defined by CAN. Ethernet can send much more data, let's say, for example, 1,500 bytes per message. So we just have to change the details of the transport layer, and then we are ready. So the work we have to do is quite small for the implementation of an XCP driver in an ECU when you have changing interfaces. XCP offers a lot of services. We talked about measurement and calibration, and but you can also use, for example, for cold start measurement. But this functionality is not mandatory. Only a few services are necessary to say, okay, this is a XCP. For example, a connection. The master have to send a connect command to the slave to say, hey, come on, I want to talk with you. And then the ECU must be able to answer this request. So this is absolutely mandatory, but for example, cold start measurement functionality or flashing, this is not mandatory in the driver. So the driver can be smaller. You need less place on the flash or RAM. XCP has a security mechanism as well. So because XCP offers you a lot of possibilities to change everything and to measure everything in the ECU, so there's a security mechanism, and it's called seed and key. Seed and key means as a master, I send a connect command to the slave. The slave answers, yes, it's okay, but please be so kind and send me a key. I send you a seed, a number, just a number, and please send me the answer back. And then the ECU itself will calculate on a special algorithm the answer for the seed, and also the master has to calculate the key. Then the master sends the key to the ECU, and the ECU compares the key that was calculated by itself and with the key of the master. If both are correctly the same, then the slave can say, okay, the master knows my algorithm. I think it's okay that he can communicate with me. The security mechanism, the seed and key function, can be divided into measurement, calibration, and flashing. So maybe you will have three different kinds of seed and key algorithms in your ECU to allow these individual topics. But this is not very often used. Most of them are using one seed and key algorithm for everything. Let's see a communication example. Here you have a part of the picture that we had before about the communication. You have the master sending a command, and you get a response from the slave. On the time axis, it looks like master sends the command, and the slave sends the response. So, for example, the user selects an object by name. In this example, it's byte counter. The master and slave, the master take a look at the address of this object in the A2L file. In this example, it's this address. And so, give me the content of address is the command from the master to the slave, and the slave answers with the content of this address. This was an example for polling. Oh, sorry, there was one question. I will go one slide back, two questions. Can you please describe what is cold start measurement? Okay. we will see a little bit later that the data acquisition mode is a mode where we first have a phase of sending communication to the slave, where we configure the slave. We are telling the slave, hey, come on, every time when your 10 millisecond cycle is over, send me information of address 1, 2, and 3. This is done by a command response communication, and after that, only information from the slave were sent to the master. That means when I make a cold start measurement, cold start means the ECU is booting and starts directly sending messages to the master. But without the communication phase before, that we where we're telling the slave, hey, come on, I'm interested in the content one of address 1, 2, and 3, we can't make a cold start measurement. With the functionality cold start measurement, that means we will send the information to the ECU, and we are telling the ECU, don't send me the information now, send me the information after the next reboot. And this is the meaning of cold start. Give configuration to the slave goes sleeping, and after it wake up, it will send directly the information. What are the transport and network layers used for XCP on CAN? The same than KWP or UDS? Does CCP XCP manage multiple frames, flow control over this? We have in XCP, XCP is managing directly all the multiple frames. This is one of the reasons why over CAN we only have 7 load bytes that we can transmit over a normal CAN bus, because we are using the first byte of the message for control and information about the multiple frames. It's not similar with KWP or UDS, because they have, for example, a very different amount of data when you request, for example, the some special information. You may get an answer of 1 byte or 500 bytes or whatever. XCP is defined a little bit different. The amount of data that was sent is combined in lists, and these lists are for CAN based on a 7-byte information. So the complexity of the protocol is quite simple. Does the seed and key have a session for connect and disconnect? It's not, I think the word session implements for me, it's a question out of diagnostic. There is no special session handling via XCP. When you make a connect, you can send an answer from the slave to the master. Okay, connection is fine, but please, we have to handle first seed and key mechanisms. Here is my seed. So it's a quite simple mechanism where the seed and key algorithm is calculated. I hope this were the right answers to your questions. Let's go ahead with the measurement kind of stuff. So, sorry, this request command and response was what we were saying. It is polling. Every single object get a request from the master to the slave. So if I want to measure every 100 millisecond a value, I have to send the request every 100 millisecond to the slave, and I will get the answer. This means we have two kinds of problems. One is the bus traffic. every time I have to send a request, and I have to, and then I get an answer. So I need at least two messages for every value. So we get a lot of bus traffic when I have to when I'm interested in a lot of information. And then there is no correspondence between the request, the answer, and the situation in the ECU. The measured data are not synchronized by itself. Imagine I send a polling request for object A and for object B. I'm sending the request and I get the answer for A. And it was sent in the calculation cycle 100 of the ECU. My next request for object B was sent by in the calculation cycle 110 of the ECU. So I get two values, but they were not calculated in the same time slot of my ECU. They must not be consistent. And for some values, it's okay. For example, the temperature of the cooling water in the vehicle. Polling is quite simple, quite easy. Every 5 seconds, I get the temperature of the ECU. That's okay. But if I want to say in detail how my algorithm is running, I can't handle it by polling. The alternative to polling is the data acquisition, the DAC kind of measurement. It's synchronized with events. What is an event? An event is a task execution in the ECU. So, for example, a 100 millisecond time slot is over in the ECU, or a 1 millisecond event is over in the time slot. Time slot is over in the ECU. Or, for example, user action, that means the driver is pressing a button, or it's another kind of single event, or it's a cyclic event, but it's not in the same time distant. So every time when the slave has the cycle is over, the event occurs, the slave will sending the right information to the master. Here I have a picture with three clocks because we have three partners talking to each other. The master is talking to this slave and the master is talking to that slave. The two slaves are not talking to each other. But this slave is sending messages and this slave is also sending messages, and all these messages are synchronized to that clock. And these messages are synchronized to that clock. And the master is getting all the data and synchronizing the information here to the time of itself, of the PC time. And then we can see the information time synchronized over from one ECU or from multiple ECUs. There is one question. What will be the timeout for seed and key? Well, this can be defined in the tool. XCP allows that you can define the timeout. How many milliseconds or how many seconds the ECU has time to calculate, or the master has time to calculate. The data acquisition allows to measure a lot of data that fits to the same calculation cycle. This was one of the problems of polling. So how is it realized? We have a sample code of the application. Here we are starting the calculation of a cycle, for example, 10 millisecond cycle. And the last command in this cycle is the call XCP event. This XCP event is jumping into the XCP driver and is telling the XCP driver, hey, event one occurs. The XCP driver takes a look at what have is there anything I have to do when event number one occurs. For example, sending some information to the master. And this is a quite simple code instrumentation that you have to do in every event special stuff of your application. So every time an XCP event with a number is calling the driver will take a look at what should I do when the event number occurs. Okay. As a user, you are selecting objects by your name and your measurement mode. For example, the 10 millisecond button or synchronized to the running of the engine or a button was pressed or whatever. And then the XCP master transmits the configuration at the beginning to the slave with the command response structure. And after that, the ECU, the slave, is just sending the information on the bus as long as the master will say stop it. Here you can see in the trace window there were some command and response things happen between the master and slave, and after that there were only the slave sending data to the bus to minimize the amount of messages we need for the communication. We will see this in Canopy later on a little bit. Calibration is quite similar. It's just a command and response communication. So, for example, we have a parameter window. It's a window to change parameters. You change the value, and the communication is realized in that way that the tool is taking a look after the, in this case, it's in this example, the object is called ample, so amplitude, and it changed the value. And on the communication side, the following is happen. The address is sended by the master to the slave. The address is realized in XCP with 5 bytes. 1 byte for the so-called extension. That means I have 4 bytes for the address plus 1 extension byte. So maybe I have a bank of memory with extension number 1 and with number 2. And so I have the same addresses in for the 4-byte addresses, but they're different in the extension, for example. So, for example, I have the same addresses for flash and RAM, and they are differentiated by the extension number. Because that the address is realized as a 5-byte value, we can't use by can everything with one command. As I mentioned before, I have only 7 bytes. I have to send the address in the first communication. So here we say the master is saying set MTI. That means I send you the address. The ECU is answering, okay, I got the address. Then I'm downloading the new value and the size of the value to the ECU. In that case, it's a 4-byte value. And I wouldn't be able to send 5-byte here and 4-byte here in one message over CAN. That does not work. This is the reason why we need 2 command and response structures for sending address and sending value. And this is special for Canopy. We do a rereading of the address. So here the user is changing the parameter value. The value, the address is sent to the ECU, the value is sent to the ECU, and after that we reread the address and to actualize the content of this window again. So If I'm changing the value from 6 to 7 and the value is jumping back to 6, then I can see, okay, my calculation does not work because my ECU has not allowed to change the value from 6 to 7. There was one question, I think, for CCP, XCP command interpretation, and what we can see on your screen, download shortable. Is it a basic feature of Canalizer, or is there an option to get it? Canalizer is a very good question. I know this tool, but not as good as I know Canopy. I think in Canalizer, I'm not sure about Canalizer. In Canopy, it's part of the basic stuff of Canopy, but I'm not sure about the Canalizer. But I can take care about this topic, and we can send the answer to ALTS after that. So now we had communication in the form of measurement. We had a communication in the form of calibration. Now we are going to stimulation and bypassing. Here you have the picture that we had before, part of the bigger picture of the communication. And what we have seen before is that the user changes a value and the messages were sent to the ECU slave. That means the calibration command is not synchronized anyway with the events in the ECU. It's just the moment when I'm pressing the button as a user. In contrast to that, the stimulation is used to send data in a synchronized way to the events of the slave. An example is bypassing. How does bypassing work? This should be an ECU. And you can see here these blocks, which this should be the function blocks of the ECU algorithm. And this algorithm called A shouldn't be calculated in the ECU, it should be calculated outside on the rapid prototyping hardware. So what you can do by bypassing is that you will measure all the data that is the input into this algorithm by DAQ measurement. You will transfer this data to, for example, a DLL, calculating the algorithm, let's say A1, and the answers, the results were calculated and send it by stimulation into the ECU again. So if this algorithm isn't calculated anyway, the communication way would not be in that way. It would be in that way. How to handle the algorithm A in the ECU? It's a little bit different from project to project, because not calculating the algorithm A means we change the timing behavior of the ECU. Sometimes it's okay, sometimes it's not. So we have to take care about the project. When we are calculating bypassing, if we want to calculate the algorithm in the ECU or not, and what are we doing if, for example, the answer of my algorithm A1 isn't quick enough in my ECU again? What will I do? I need a concept. How to handle if there is an error? Will I take the results of algorithm A, or will I take the last values I get from algorithm A1? Stuff like that. But this is not part of XCP. XCP is not defining all these individual questions. It's just offering the possibility of communication. How to bypass, or how to find the right answers, what does fit best to my project? This is not defined by XCP. You have to take care about these things in another context. One thing is very important, it's the A2L file. As I mentioned very early, the address of an object and the name of an object are stored in the A2L file, in the description file. That means if I have version A in my ECU and version B defined in my A2L file, that will not fit together. I will take wrong addresses. And sorry. The A2L file and the content of the ECU must always fit together. And what is inside an ECU, what is inside an A2L file, something that, let's say, driver settings, for example, let's say XCP on CAN, we need two messages defined to send messages from the master to the slave and the other way around, another message. So I need two messages. But what are my messages? Without the information in my A2L file, I would not know as a master which message ID should I use for the communication to my slave. Also, the information is inside, should I use seeding key or not? Where is my memory layout? Everything is defined in my A2L file, plus all the objects. The objects, the data type of the objects and their addresses, they are defined in the linker map file. Nearly everybody has different ways to generate an A2L file. We are offering two different ways. I will just jump one slide back. One is use Canopy, our master tool, reading the linker map file and actualize the A2L file, for example. Or get more objects out of the linker map file and add them to the A2L file. We have a complete A2L editor in Canopy to take a look after the A2L files and to manipulate them. The other way is using a complete software build process. This picture is quite complex, sorry for that, but let's start explaining a little bit here on the left side. You are writing your code, hand-coded or model-based. If it's hand-coded, we can pass over the code and taking a look after special comments. And with the creator, we are creating information regarding these objects. The creator is part of our so-called ASAP tool set, where we can create A2L objects, where we can update the addresses, where we can merge multiple A2L files to one big A2L files, where we can compare, modify, and check A2L files. These tools, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 tools, are controlled by command line and can be used completely in a makefile process. No manual things is necessary. You have no GUI to make any action. So the creator has the content of the parameter or the measurement object, and it knows the data type. And within updater and the map file, we can update the addresses of the objects. And we may have another kind of different A2L files. For example, the content of this A2L file is the interface-specific command information. It's about CAN, it's about XCP on Ethernet, then we need an IP address and stuff like that. We have a layout, we have conversion rules and stuff like that. And all the things together, with the merger, we can get a complete A2L file. So if you have questions regarding a complete software build process, we can talk about later on. I think it's too much for this session here. How can we get the XCP into the ECU? Here we can use, it's a picture, the ECU may have the XCP driver inside. That means we need RAM and flash resources. We need the driver implementation inside the ECU code. And then we can communicate with the ECU. For example, on CAN, this is totally wrong what you can see here. It's not 50 megabit per second, it's 50 kilobit per second. Sorry. It would be very nice to see 50 megabit per second via CAN. Would be very interesting. Sorry for that. We can realize about a measurement volume of 50 kilobit per second. The other possibility is to use an external hardware to realize an XCP port of the ECU. We have a so-called VX solution. VX means vector XCP, and it's divided into two parts. One is a so-called plug-on device, a small hardware that is directly connected to the ECU, and this is connected to a so-called base module, and this is talking about XCPs on Ethernet. So at the end, this hardware is just representing an XCP on Ethernet interface to the ECU, and this is normally, it depends a little bit on the processor, that we have no or a very, very low controller resource that we need for handling the data out of the ECU or into the ECU. So these two different possibilities were available for getting XCP to the ECU. There's one question. I understand the A2L file must follow a format. I guess it is the same for map file. I think I didn't get the point. A2L is a format by itself. It described in a special way how the objects look like. And the map files are depending on the compiler you are using. You may have an ELF or dwarf file or stuff like that. And every compiler format is different. And what we can do is we understand these different compiler formats, and then we get the information out of the linker map file and put them into the A2L file. But the format of A2L and the format of map is totally different. There's another question. 50 kilobit, would I say? Because normally we have a lot of, the ECU has to do some things, and we can't realize 500 kilobit on CAN. It's too much for the complete process. If you are using XCP directly as a driver in your ECU, there is a way of code instrumentation that you need. This example is part of the book. You can see here later on in chapter 5, where it is explained where how to connect your application to the XCP protocol layer and the XCP transport layer. So I don't want to talk about all these different details because of the time, but you can get an deeper information in the XCP book that you can download or order by us for free. Some use cases. I was always talking about ECU, but this is not correct. You can use XCP in multiple way. It's not only in a real ECU. You can use it, for example, in Simulink. Your model is running in Simulink, and we are putting an XCP slave into the Simulink model, and we can communicate with the Simulink model like with an ECU. The behavior is different, so the timing behavior of a Simulink model is quite different from a real-time behavior of an ECU. But this is absolutely okay, no problem for that. Or you can use it on your prototype hardware, or as on a DLL running on your PC, or in a Hill or a SIL system. So XCP is the measurement and calibration protocol over the complete model of development, the V model of the development. And this is quite nice, because of you can use the same configuration, the same protocol, if you are using it for bypassing on rapid prototyping in Simulink or in your ECU or everywhere. You can use the same configuration, you have the same kind of handling, A2L files, the measurement files, the configurations, everything can be realized on the same way. And this offers a lot of possibilities without changing configurations and getting information from one system to another system. Before we go to the tool, just some more information where you get additional possibilities to inform yourself. For example, in our download center, you can see here some possibilities to select what are you interested in. I just put it into this slide. And then you get, for example, the XCP master. It's, in this case, it's Canopy 12. You can download it in a demo mode. And with the demo mode, there is also an XCP slave where you can communicate and play with it. If you're interested more on the ECU side, with the code, you can download our XCP sample implementation. To take a look at it, everything is inside what you need for measurement and calibration. Not for flashing or cold start measurement or stuff like that, but for measurement and calibration. If you need a professional driver, a driver that is implemented for your, for example, AUTOSAR specific code, we are selling an XCP driver as well. But these things you can see here are for free. When you implement or when you download Canopy, when you want to start Canopy, there is the way here, program Canopy demos, XCP demos, just to explain how to get to the right demo. Additional information are from the reference book XCP in the download center. You can download it as a PDF or in some ebook formats. And there is an additional information when you want to see it in a more AUTOSAR specific way. There is an AUTOSAR calibration manual as well in the download center to download the information that is necessary for the understanding of XCP and AUTOSAR. Okay, just some more slides. You get these slides if you want to download them. To give you an example how we can handle Canopy with different slaves. All the slides before were about XCP and not very specific for vector products. These things are specific for Canopy. How to make a mill environment model in the loop or a software in the loop solution for Canopy. So Canopy can be your software in the loop environment as well as it can be used in a Hill environment and stuff like that. Because of the time, I want to go to the tool. I started it already, but what you can do is when you have your programs. So for example here, Vector Canopy, you can go to the demos and then start your XCP demo. And then this will happen. you will get an XCP ECU, simulated ECU, it's called XCP Sim, and the canopy project itself. But there was a question about UDS and XCP. There's one question. For example, UDS can be used to read and write ECU data, and UDS also includes flashing function. XCP measure and calibration also can do similar work. What is different between those two standards and how? It ends. Okay, I think how to realize it. UDS and the other diagnostic stuff are realized as a structure of commands. That means you can send a command to the ECU, and in the ECU, the code is defined. What should I do with this command? And my answer is specified in the code of the ECU. XCP is different. You have your possibilities to make a read-write access, and you have the possibility to get it event-driven. So every time when the event occurs in the ECU, the data will be sent to the master. This is something diagnostic protocols can't handle. And flashing via XCP is normally not used when you are in the near of start of production, because the flashing mechanism in XCP is quite simple. There is no process around like calculating hash algorithms, is it allowed or not, or stuff like that. So flashing might be very complex, and this is normally every time used via diagnostic protocols. So you are right, you can use both tools for read-write access to your memory, but it depends on what you want to do. If protocol UDS is better than usable for this specific topic than XCP, for example. Are there any big differences between CCP flashing and XCP flashing? No. Sorry for this short answer. I just want to go back to this example of XCP. I just put some messages, some objects here into a window, and I have some parameters here, and I can see here the trace window. I just clean the trace window here. Start the measurement, stop the measurement. Okay. What you can see here is all the kind of communication we have before the measurement. I'm realizing the measurement, the configuration of the measurement of these information here by DAC mechanisms. And after that, the ECU is just sending the data. How is this realized? I will just close these windows to show you how easy that is. So for example, here is the content of the A2L file. This is the A2L file. Here are the objects that are described. And I can just select these kind of objects and say, okay, give it to me to the window here. I want to measure them. And I want to change, for example, the value of the amplitude. Now I selected the names of the object. I may control the measurement mode. For example, I will just measure something else. Let's say this one. So I can set up my configuration, what I'm interested in, and then I can control how is my measurement signal measured. What is the measurement mode for it? For example, these information here or here, and I put them in a 10 millisecond event. I just can change, for example, this as well in that way, and I want to change this in polling, for example, every 100 millisecond, or let's say 10 millisecond. It's okay. This is not inside because I selected it as a calibration object, but I can measure it as well. Okay, so now we'll make a trace window just to show you the content of the communication, just starting the measurement. And what I can see here now is some response messages, command messages, and duck. Command response because I'm using one thing as polling. Duck mechanisms because I'm using these objects here in an event-driven way. And now I can change, for example, the value. And now I can directly see what is the result of my changing. Okay, so it's quite simple. The A2L file, I can open it with the A2L editor, contains some groups and some additional information. So, for example, record layouts. Record layout is necessary to describe complex objects. Some simple objects, for example, like measure signals here, channel 1, is a float value. It has an address. This address is updated from the linker map file. It has a description of the data type. It may have a display, a physical display. So in that case, maybe I can exchange the conversion rules, for example, quite easy linear with factor and offset, or complex that remembers me in very typical way to my study, and other stuff, other possibilities to change. I can also select an already given conversion rule, for example. Okay. And there's some additional information. One is here, XCP. I can define in the A2L file, for example, what is my duck event I want to measure the object. And if I would define, it's always fixed measured by, for example, this event, I can't measure it in another way. Every time I put it in a window, it's automatically integrated in my measurement list with this measurement mode. Okay. Is there a question? Yes. What version of XCP is supported in Canopy 12? Every version. It starts 2003 with number 1.0, and we are working in the XCP ASAM group, and we are defining XCP in the group together with other companies, and we are implementing directly also the examples for the XCP master and slave. So we are on the edge of the development of XCP. One thing in this A2L file, for example, is also to make an update of the addresses. So when I connected the linker map file to the A2L file, I can do this quite simple here, what kind of map files I'm supporting here. So these are the linker map files we can understand. And then we can read in and make an update of the addresses. So the user itself is able to make an update of the addresses. Okay. So this is quite similar to measurement calibration on all this kind of stuff. Canopy can do much more things, handling parameter files and all this kind of stuff. We have no time at the moment to take a closer look at the XCP specific information in Canopy, but it wasn't the goal of this hour. The goal was to give you an overview over the XCP protocol itself, and I hope you find some information useful for you. The next step from our side will be that we will send you an email where you can give us a feedback over the webinar, and you can download our presentation with this information you have seen before in the presentation, in the slides. There's one question about the tool. Is the A2L editor independent or linked to Canopy? Every Canopy license contains an A2L editor. I will go back to the last slide. Just one moment. Yeah, because here you can see some more details. We have the ASAP2 editor as a standalone tool as well. Sorry. And we have also an ASAP2 viewer. This is a free of charge viewer in the download center, where you can, if you just want to take a look at the A2L file, you don't want to change it, you can just use the ASAP2 viewer for free of charge. If you are using, if you work a lot of only on A2L files, you don't need the measurement and calibration capabilities of Canopy. You can just buy the editor. It's much cheaper than the Canopy itself. But Canopy every time contains an A2L editor by itself. What is the limitation for demo version Canopy tool? You can't change, you can't store configurations. The amount of A2L objects is limited. I don't know the exact number. And the amount of data you can measure is limited. There is a Canopy plugin in Canoe. Does it have some restrictions comparing to Canopy? Sorry, but there is no real Canopy plugin in Canoe. There is an XCP option for Canoe. The point of view of Canoe is different to Canopy. Canoe has a test background, and it wants to make a test, and for the test, maybe next test step, a value out of the ECU itself is necessary for the test. Then you can use the XCP option to have access to the read-write access to the ECU memory, and for that you can use XCP. But there is no real Canopy plugin for Canoe. Record layouts in A2L files. What are the options to automatically create those based on the model-generated and hand-generated code? Complex question. When you are creating out of model, out of Simulink, an A2L file, just use our ASAP2 toolset, our toolset that is part of Canopy as well. We have a MATLAB integration package that is you can download it as well in the download center, and this has to be implemented on the PC where you run your Simulink, and with that you can use your target code, your Simulink coder, I think is the right name, the real-time workshop, to generate an A2L file out of your model. Because for the handmade code, I'm not quite sure what there is possible. Sorry, I have no real idea at the moment what there is possible for the C code part. We can take a look at the A2L content, the record formats, the record layouts, let's say here, just one this. You can say there is how many access points do you have, it's how is the alignment, what are the components of this. Let's go to maps working point, for example. Address, moment, link a map, physical, documentation. Here's some information about the access type. Well, I think for the, I haven't the deeper knowledge about the C code implementation of a record layout in the C code. But if you are using our XCP example, I will just jump some slides back. Yes, the XCP slave code. There you get information because there is an there are some code examples where you can take a look at the realized record layouts in this code as well. If you don't find all your information, please send me an email, and I will investigate a little bit more to get you to find the right information for you. How do we make downloadable flash block? Pooh. Flashing in the XCP point of view, it's quite simple. You make download file to flash. You select your hex file. You can see here some things about data or code. It depends on the configuration. And then flashing is just realized regarding to the memory information you have in your A2L file. This is a special view on the A2L file. This device configuration here is the view on the A2L part with the communication part, where the memory flash is defined and where the other segments are defined, some information about protocols and stuff like that. And XCP is just using a binary file and sending it to the ECU. You can use a flash kernel to remove the flash content before and stuff like that. But I'm not quite sure if your question is going to the question how to make it out of your code. And this is very specific and depends on your environment. But if you have your code generation process, compiler, linker, then you get your binary file, then you can download it via XCP. So I think I didn't get the point so far. So if there is a deeper question that I didn't get now, please send me an email again, because this question I can't answer at the moment. Is there an XCP sample implementation over Lin? No. We can realize XCP on Lin. XCP on Lin is not an ASAM standard. We defined a solution some years ago that combines the Lin possibilities and the XCP possibilities together to define an XCP on Lin. But we do not have a free XCP on Lin implementation. But you can buy it by our colleagues from the embedded systems. So if this is necessary as well, send me an email. I will get the right information for you. Is flashing possible in Canopy? If yes, which tool is used? Yes, it is possible. You can flash via CCP, you can flash via XCP, you can call our vflash tool. So for example here, I'm on the right place here, I can say flash via XCP. Or I can say flash via VFlash. VFlash is a tool from us that is working on diagnostic stuff. And you can just set up the VFlash configuration. You need an actual VFlash configuration that fits to your ECU. You can select it. I do not have one. And then every time when you use flash file, download file to ECU, then it will use the VFlash or the XCP communication. It depends on your configuration of Canopy. There's some mechanism to route XCP from CAN into XCP over FlexRay. This is nothing that you can just take out of the box and use. I think we realized some projects in that case, but it's not so simple because XCP on FlexRay is a little bit different for that, and you need a real gateway with a lot of functionality. So nothing from the box, but if you have the need for such a project, I can give you the right contacts for that. How to create object file for calibrated data? I will go just to the project and trying to find my A2L file. Yes, here. I will just open it with Notepad. Hey, come on. I will take another one. On my parameters, I'm just remembering here. This is a characteristic. This is a map, but anyway, it's a kind of parameter, and it's defined in the A2L file as a so-called characteristic. So if you define a parameter, you have to begin with a begin characteristic, then you explain the content of this object in the language of the A2L file. And the other thing is begin measurement. Measurement is an object that I can measure. So A2L and XCP are strongly using two different ways of communication. Just reading, it's measurement, characteristic for measurement, and for reading and writing. So in Canopy, when you're using not an ASCII editor, if you're using Canopy, you can, for example, just select the list of, I may use it in here, editor settings, search, no, F4. This means I'm just loading the content of my linker map file here, and I can select, for example, this one. I'm saying, okay, I want to have this object out of my linker map file with this data type, this address. Okay, and then it's asking me, is this a measurement value? Is it a parameter? I say, okay, it's a parameter. Here it is. And then I can work on it, and I just can, for example, make a conversion rule for it or give a unit or stuff like that. Then I added this parameter into my A2L file with information out of my linker map file. Or I can say, for example, here, new parameter, and I can take all the information and all the things I need manually into the A2L file. So it's quite simple to add objects into an A2L file. Next question, is calibration possible without Canopy GUI? I mean, I meant using XCP commands. Yes, this is possible. In Canopy, we have the possibility to use functions and scripts. And you can realize scripts, for example, to send information to the ECU. And this is one possibility to without a GUI. So for example, you have a kind of learning algorithm realized in the script language. And this is changing automatically parameters, measuring the results and calculating if the quality of the change is good or not. So you can use learning algorithms, or you can use an automatic system, like for example MATLAB, to control Canopy, and that Canopy then will handle all the XCP A2L stuff, and the learning algorithm is running outside Canopy in MATLAB, for example. Okay, a lot of questions. Thank you very much. This is one of the reasons why we get out of time a little bit. I hope this was interesting for you. As I mentioned before, we will send you an email. Thank you for your time and your questions. And in the email, you will get the possibility to give us a feedback and to download the presentation. And I think it's time to say goodbye. Thank you very much. Oh, there's one additional question, I think. Once the data is changed by calibration, how to create hex file? changing a parameter in the ECU means changing it in the RAM. So the next time the ECU is booting, the changing is lost. So the normal way is that we are saving the change parameters in different formats. We can select what we want to have, CDF2.0, PACO, DCM, or whatever. This is one possibility to save the information. The other one is to save the parameter set in a binary format. And we can also just take a look. I'm used with Canopy 13, and the menu structure is a little bit different. So sorry, just want to store here. Yeah, here it is. For example, save and flash parameter set. What does that mean? I can save my parameters in a format, and I integrate the parameters into the hex file, and then I'm flashing the hex file. So we can change the parameters not only in the ECU, we can change it offline in the hex file itself, and then changing this hex file, and then we can flash the flash file. Okay. If you have any more questions, my email address is part of the email or part of the presentation. And so if you have any questions, please do not hesitate to contact me, and I will try to get the answers to you. Thank you very much for your time, and goodbye.